Yeltsin's government in Moscow. As his influence increases, he obtains key jobs for colleagues from St. Petersburg. A few years later, Putin will be the first to benefit. Chubais invents a system of privatization, which makes a clear break with the economic rules of the Soviet regime.
Before the fall of the Soviet Union, promising businessmen had been given state assets to manage. They were the first to benefit from this new system of privatization.
This new businessman decided that now they're free, they're their own masters. And for a while, they became what we know as oligarchs.
But the oligarchs had forgotten their moral contract to manage the property for the state. They would learn to regret it. In the meantime, they became millionaires overnight. The country is in a turmoil. Ordinary Russians quickly understand that they will not be the ones to benefit from the system of privatization. As for members of the political class, their views prefer to differ.
President Yeltsin attempts to modify the constitution and impose his policy of privatization. Russian parliament and the people resist. Yeltsin sends in the tanks. More than 150 people are killed. For the Russians, it's the first step towards the end of their dream for democracy. Observing the events from St. Petersburg, Putin realizes that from now on, in Yeltsin's democracy, the rules are going to be dictated.
When Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, democracy was the most popular word. 2 years later, it became a swear word.
They call it democracy, which is shitocracy, if you translate it.
A year later, Yeltsin's tanks move in again, this time in Chechnya. The Chechens are demanding their independence and they must be prevented from taking control over the Russian pipeline crossing their lands. After a two-year war and 80,000 victims, Chechnya obtains a peace settlement in its favor. For the Russians, it is a humiliating defeat. For Putin, it is far worse. Yeltsin is guilty of committing a crime against the state. Chechnya is part of Russia. Chechnya should be forced to submit.
In St. Petersburg, Putin organizes Sobchak's re-election campaign as mayor. Yeltsin has betrayed his democratic obligations, and if Sobchak wins these elections, Yeltsin's old ally could become a serious contender for the presidency. At Yeltsin's request, the oligarchs refuse to help Sobchak finance his campaign.
In 1996, Yeltsin organized a manhunt against him. He saw in Sobchak an opponent to be removed from the political stage.
Sobchak loses the elections, and Putin is outraged by the increasing political power of the oligarchs. Declaring his loyalty to his political benefactor, he refuses to work with the new mayor. His future and that of Russia lie in Moscow.
After being a deputy mayor of St. Petersburg and nearly getting himself to jail for his connections with organized crime, he was actually made an official in the presidential administration.
Noting Putin's hard work and loyalty towards Sobchak, Anatoly Chubais finds him a position in the Kremlin State Property Department. The 1996 presidential elections are only a few weeks off, and Yeltsin's fears are justified. He has lost the confidence of the population. The communists are back in force. Their leader, Gennady Zhuganov, is the favorite in the polls.
Without politics, you are not able to protect your capital. Those people, the first in Russia, rich people who realize they need to take political responsibility for the future of the country. Because we already felt that time that reformers, headed by Yeltsin, are not able to stop communists. And it's the reason why we met together to cooperate and to win elections.
From inside the Kremlin, Putin watches the oligarchs transform what seemed an inevitable defeat into victory. Money and television make their stage entrance into Russian politics. Yeltsin names Berezovsky head of state television and finances NTV, the private station belonging to the millionaire Vladimir Gusinsky. Yeltsin becomes a TV czar and television the major tool for his re-election.
It was clear from the experience which they had in 96 that the next presidential campaign will demand two major tools. One is a Russian TV channel which is going to support the next president, and a company which is going financially to stay behind the electoral campaign and support the candidate financially.
The oil company Sibneft is created with Roman Abramovich, Berezovsky's intriguing young business partner, as chairman. The state TV, directed by Boris Berezovsky, becomes a tool for state propaganda. A system is born to promote Yeltsin's successor. The elections are hardly over when Yeltsin falls ill again. He dedicates his powers to the oligarchs Berezovsky and Abramovich, who have won their gamble in using their money to obtain political power. They literally command the country with other members of a group known as the Family. It includes Yeltsin's own daughter, Tatiana, and her future husband. The oligarchs are looking for someone young, serious, but unpretentious, who will suit Yeltsin as his successor. Obedient and efficient, Vladimir Putin seems the perfect choice.
In 1998, the Family proposed Putin as head of the FSB, the former KGB. It is a decisive and symbolical step in his career, a chance to prove his loyalty and render important services to the regime. Although a former KGB lieutenant colonel, Vladimir Putin is the first civilian in history to be nominated to this post. He now finally occupies the seat that his mentor Yuri Andropov had left 16 years earlier.
These oligarchs were hoping that Putin, who was promoted only to the rank of lieutenant colonel, which is not really very high, is not going to be loyal to FSB the way a general of FSB is going to be loyal.
But what the oligarchs fail to realize is that Vladimir Putin has never abandoned the KGB spirit and its ideology. He feels invested with a mission, and in the shadows, he patiently awaits his hour.
Protected by their political status, the oligarchs triple their fortunes, dilapidate millions, and invest massively offshore. In the meantime, many Russians are finding it hard to subsist. In summer 1998, the economic crash is inevitable. Yeltsin needs a firm hand at the helm to reassure the population. A KGB prime minister appears his best option. The first one, Soviet-style Evgeny Primakov, takes his mission too seriously and declares that he will put a halt to corruption and throw the oligarchs in jail. The population jubilates. Yeltsin and the Family feel distinctly worried. Confident in the people's support, Primakov turns a blind eye. He nominates a new general prosecutor, Yuri Skuratov, to assist him. Skuratov's first inquiry starts within the walls of the Kremlin itself and concerns its sumptuous renovation. $66 million have been embezzled, and are to be found on the bank accounts of high-ranking civil servants and members of the family. The general prosecutor is treading dangerous ground.
A criminal inquiry was opened. Technically, it was simple enough. The problem was Yeltsin himself was directly involved.
And Yeltsin could not throw the prosecutor out because he had no legitimate legal power. So he asked Mr. Putin, could you do anything? And he said, yeah, well, no problem, we'll do it. So, you know, the prosecutor was framed at the KGB safe house with some of the prostitutes, and it was all on camera and shown on Russian television.
The director of the FSB, Vladimir Putin, has announced that the pictures of the man resembling Yuri Skuratov are authentic. They've been confirmed as being those of the general prosecutor.
Skuratov is forced to resign.
Putin, in the eyes of Yeltsin, became someone who would never let him down. And in that sense, he is probably right. Putin keeps his word. I mean, in that sense, he knows his superiors, and he never betrayed them so far. And that's a fact. That's part of his character.
For Yeltsin, Mr. Putin, the head of the FSB, has passed his test. He deserves a reward.
Я решил назвать человека, который, по моему мнению, способен консолидировать общество. Владимир Владимирович Путин.
Putin's nomination as prime minister in August 1999 confirms that he has been approved of by the whole family, but he's still unknown to the population.
No one knew him. Everyone was asking, who is this Putin man? Do you remember that question? Who is Mr. Putin? So he had to show who he was. And that's when we had the explosions in the Moscow apartment blocks.
In 3 weeks, explosions in several Russian towns kill 300 people. The government immediately accuses the Chechen rebels. But when another explosion is nipped in the bud and two terrorists are arrested, the Kremlin surprisingly orders the police to stop inquiries. Journalists discover what could well become a state affair. The terrorists in question are in fact members of the FSB. NTV, the TV station belonging to Vladimir Gusinsky, broadcasts a debate on the implication of the FSB in the explosions, where FSB officials accuse one another of collusion. The public still finds this hard to believe, but journalists are pursuing their investigations, and as Prime Minister, Putin realizes that there is no time to be lost. He must create a diversion. He decides to exploit the population's hatred for the Chechens.
You see, Chechnya has always been the politician's grave. A lot of people were afraid and thought Putin should keep his distance. But he was determined. To general surprise, it played in his favor. The middle class became angry. Putin reacted in the same way. This is when he started to build his image, saying, I'm a man like you. I'm the head of state, but I'm the same as you.
Мы будем преследовать террористов везде, в аэропорту, значит, вы уж меня извините, в туалете поймаем, мы и в сортире их замочим, в конце концов. Все, вопрос закрыт окончательно.
Я думаю, Путин становится...
It's at this moment that Putin really becomes Putin. He acquires his own language, freedom of expression, and complicity with the Russian people. He's no longer afraid of his public.
For the last three centuries, many Russians and their leaders have resented the Chechen bandits, as they call them. The Chechens have always refused to submit to Russian dominance. Stalin deported them by thousands. Yeltsin's peace treaty is felt as a humiliation, and for the population, the recent explosions are a provocation. Their prime minister, Vladimir Putin, is entirely justified in declaring